Dear Father in heaven, we are here on this Sabbath to invite you into our midst. We are thankful, Lord, for all the blessings that you give us. And we ask, Lord, that as we open your word today, that your Holy Spirit can be here to teach us. We know, Lord, we're looking back, as Sister White said, that we have nothing to fear for the future except we forget the way the Lord has led us and his teaching in our past history. And we just ask, Lord, that you can illuminate our minds, that you can give us an understanding heart, and that we can see the part that our church has played and will play in human events. Mostly, Lord, we ask that you can be close to each one here, that you can lead us in our personal lives. And we just pray, Lord, that as we look to your word, as we look to how you have led the church, that we will also realize, Lord, how you have led us, and that we will learn to trust in you fully, even when things look dark. And we ask this all in the name of thy precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, welcome, everyone. I'm just turning off my phone here so it doesn't ring, and you might want to do the same. So I'm presenting today three lectures, about an hour in length each, on the foundations of Adventism, and I'm going to go through in detail the 1843 chart, which you see on my right side, the 1850 chart here, and also the 1863 chart, which I do not have a large copy of. Now, we're all familiar, at least I hope all of us are. How many people are not familiar with the charts at all? Everyone here? Okay. There's one person here who's not familiar. Now, some of us have different levels, and what I'm going to try to do is present the charts at varying levels. So there's going to be each of these studies on the charts is also going to go through an aspect of Bible prophecy. So, you know, Rick will get his wish to have Islam. We're going to go look at Islam because that's on the 1843 charts in detail. When we go to the 1850 chart, we will look at America in Bible prophecy. And when we get to the 1863 chart, we're going to look at the seven times prophecy, and also how it relates to the 70 weeks prophecy. So we're going to look at the crucifixion of Christ and the prophecies relating to that. So this is a quote from the Spirit of Prophecy. And it says, "When the time passed at which the Lord's coming was first expected, in the spring of 1844, those who had looked in faith for his appearing were for a season involved in doubt and uncertainty. And while the world regarded them as having been utterly defeated and proved to have been cherishing a delusion, their source of consolation was still the Word of God. Many continued to search the Scriptures, examining anew the evidences of their faith and carefully studying the prophecies to obtain further light. The Bible testimony in support of their position seemed clear and conclusive. Signs which could not be mistaken pointed to the coming of Christ as near. The special blessing of the Lord, both in the conversion of sinners and the revival of spiritual life among Christians, had testified that the message was of heaven. And though the believers could not explain their disappointment, they felt assured that God had led them in their past experience. Interwoven with the prophecies which they had regarded as applying to the time of the Second Advent was instruction specially adapted to their state of uncertainty and suspense, and encouraging them to wait patiently. In the faith that was now dark to their understanding, would in due time be made plain. Among these prophecies was that of Habakkuk 2, verse 1 to 4. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower, and I will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, Write the vision, and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end, it shall speak and not lie, though it tarry. Wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him. But the just shall live by his faith. And that's from Great Controversy, page 391. And you can see the chart on the right side is that chart that was made. And it says, in as early as 1842, the direction given in this prophecy to write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it, had suggested to Charles Fitch the preparation of a prophetic chart to illustrate the visions of Daniel in Revelation. The publication of this chart was regarded as a fulfillment of the command given by Habakkuk. No one, however, then noticed that an apparent delay in the accomplishment of the vision, a tarrying time, is presented in the same prophecy. After the disappointment, this scripture appeared very significant. The vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The just shall live by his faith. So here on this chart, when does this chart end, the 1843 chart?
Second coming.
Well, what year? 1843, which is why we call it the 1843 chart. But it was made in 1842. The other two charts, we named them because of the year they were made. Now, the disappointment that's being talked about is the first disappointment, which was in the spring of 1844. I don't have time to get into the Midnight Cry, but I suggest that you look up the Midnight Cry and read about it in Spirit of Prophecy. What happened from the time of the disappointment to the first day of the fifth month, when the Midnight Cry was given on a Wednesday, August 14th, 1844, when Samuel Snow came riding into the camp meeting, and Joseph Bates gave the pulpit to Snow, and he presented a message, which I'm going to go through a little bit and explain. But that was the tarrying time. And so now they were encouraged by the fact that they had made a chart with this prophecy on it that explained. So this chart was a fulfillment of prophecy. They did not anticipate this, and that gave them faith. So a large illustrated chart was produced for William Miller in 1842 by Joshua Himes. So there you see the chart. Ellen White says about this chart some interesting things, which we're going to look at. But she says, I have seen that the 1843 chart was directed by the hand of the Lord, and that it should not be altered, that the figures were as he wanted them, that his hand was over and hid a mistake in some of the figures, so that none could see it until his hand was removed. And that's from Early Writings, page 74. Of course, the figures is not referring to the pictures, but it's referring to the numbers on the chart. Now, later in Early Writings, it says this regarding the 1843 chart. The hand of the Lord was removed from the figures, and the mistake was explained. They saw that the prophetic periods reached to 1844, and that the same evidence which they had presented to show that the prophetic periods closed in 1843 prove that they would terminate in 1844. Light from the Word of God shone upon their position, and they discovered a tarrying time. Though it, the vision, tarry, wait for it. So this is the time when the mistake was explained, was between the spring of 1843 and August 14th, 1844. And that's in the Midnight Cry. So the mistake was explained here by inspiration, by the Bible, not by Ellen White. She didn't point out what the mistake was. It was explained in the Millerite movement itself. So we're just going to go through a little bit of the organization of this chart, which is important in understanding as we go through each of the charts. They all have some similarities and some differences. We can see that Christ is in the center of the chart. So if you can see the chart over there, you may not be able to see it if you're way over on this side too well, but you can see it here. Christ is the center of this chart. There's a timeline on the left side with the image that runs down the left column, and it goes from 700 And the first date on the chart is 677 BC, and it goes all the way down to the bottom to 1844. There's also a timeline in the center of the chart, and this begins at 677 and goes to 1843. Daniel's prophecies are on the top left part of the chart. So we have Daniel chapter 2 with the image, Daniel chapter 7 with the beasts, and we also have Daniel chapter 8 with the ram and the goat. And then we have Revelation's prophecies on the bottom right-hand side of the chart. And this chart was used by Millerite preachers. There were 300 that were produced. And it's called the 1843 chart because it ends in 1843, even though it was made in 1842. Okay, on the top right-hand corner of the prophetic period are the prophetic periods that were later, under the Midnight Cry, seen to end on October 22nd, 1844. So when Ella White talks about the figures that were first seen to end in 1843, that were then seen to end in 1844 based upon the same evidence, she's talking about the prophetic figures at the top right-hand corner of the chart. And those are the 2300 days and the seven times. So we're just going to look really briefly here. It says the 25-20-year prophecy is found in the top right-hand corner of the chart. It is the longest time prophecy in the Bible, reaching from the earliest date on the chart, 677 BC, to the latest date on the chart, 1843. And just a little bit about the calculation. So Miller, when he shows the calculation on the chart here, he has the seven times of Leviticus there mentioned with the number seven, 12 months in a year. So in 7 years, there's 84 months and 30 days in a month, and he comes up with 25-20 years. First they're days, but they're taken prophetically as years. Now he had two ways in which he interpreted this prophecy, and we're going to look at it in more detail, but he has one that deals with the northern kingdom, which ends in 1798, and another one that deals with the southern kingdom, Judah, which ended, as he thought, first in 1843, but they found later ended in 1844. So you can see here, the 1843, they just did a simple subtraction. They did not look at the fullness of the year. At the top right-hand corner. So am I going too fast? Is everybody following this? Okay, because to me, I understand this completely. So, you know, it all makes sense every time I'm saying it, at least to me. Okay, at the top right-hand corner of the 1843 chart, just under the calculation for the 25-20-year prophecy, you will find the 2300-year prophecy. And its beginning date in 457 BC. So you can see it's here, it's also in the center column. So that's that 457 BC there with the 538 above it is in the center column. And then we also have it right next to it with the mathematical calculation, which again does not account for the fullness of the year. Now, both the 1843 and the 1850 chart have the image of Daniel chapter 2, the metal man. And here's just a little closer look at it. So obviously anybody can come and look at these charts if they want to. I also, if anybody's interested, I can send them files of these charts, but you can get them on the internet as well. But if you want to print out ones like I have here, I printed them from high quality files. So you can see that we have Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, and then we also have Daniel chapter 8 dealing with the goats, right? Divisions, the ram. And then we also have the little horn. And, oops, went too far. So we have a few different things in here. We can see some. Christ is surrounded by all these beasts here, pagan Rome and papal Rome and so forth. So we're all familiar with these images. Now, along the center column, there's many major dates in history that are represented elsewhere on the chart. Now, these dates are not all prophecies. So when Ellen White Tech talks about the figures on the chart of the prophetic periods that it ended in 1843, that were directed by the hand of the Lord, she's not referring to every detail on the chart. Okay? There's some things on these charts which are just historical dates that they put on the chart so that you can get a flow of history. And some of these dates are in dispute, which I'm going to deal with at the end of this lecture, as the errors on the chart and what are the supposed errors and what those errors are. But we can see that it has these various dates: the overthrow of ancient Babylon in 538, third decree to rebuild Jerusalem in 457. Of course, that is a part of prophecy. Greece overthrows Media-Persia in 332. There's no prophecy that says that that's going to happen. It's just an event. Okay. Obviously, the taking away of the daily sacrifice and the rise of the little horn are part of prophecy, as is 1798. 1843 is just incorrect because of the calculation mistake. Now here we have the daily on the chart, and of course this is a little bit of a hot topic in Adventism right now, but it is clear that the Adventist pioneers were united upon their view of the daily, and we can see this well represented on the chart. The date 508 and the taking away of the daily. We also find the daily in the center column. It says 1290 years, Daniel 12 verse 11, commencing 508 at the taking away of the daily sacrifice, terminate in 1798, from which period 45 years complete the 1335 years when Daniel is to stand in his lot at the end of days, right? Now, we also have the beasts, pagan and papal Rome, and some of these things weren't completely understood by the Millerites. Now, one of the things that I found as I've studied through Adventist history, there's things that people, you know, will point to out as error. And some people will say, well, you know, this is a major error. But some things they just did not have fully revealed. So is a partial understanding of truth, is it true when God gives you insight? There's many things we have in our own experience where we understood something, God gives us more light. It doesn't mean everything that we believed before was wrong. We just now understand more about it. It's not like we cast out what we believed before as error. It's just now new insights. And that's what we see unfolding in Adventist history, is that they're understanding things as history unfolds that were hidden from their view prior to those things being unfolded. We have the text of Revelation, so we can see here 12 verse 3 and 4 is above the dragon beast. And we also have how pagan Rome stood up against the Prince of Princes. So it says that when we find out that it was pagan Rome that stood up against the Prince of Princes, not Antiochus Epiphanes. Right? So they're very clear on that chart, on the chart regarding that, and we'll look at that maybe really briefly later. I don't think I put that on here actually. So, but the date of Antiochus Epiphanes, he did not stand up against the Prince of Princes. Yes? Okay. Now, so we see the leopard-like beast. We see the Pope riding on the papal beast. And it, now this is a part of the 1843 chart that is, you know, we have more light on. So this is dealing with the three woes of Revelation 9. Now the trumpets. When I first became an Adventist and we had a Bible study group in my house, there were people with all kinds of speculative things about the trumpets. They were mixing them with the plagues and so forth, and they were taking literal time prophecies from them. At the time, I was, you know, fairly naive. I didn't know about all the winds of doctrine in Adventism, but I could tell that these things were not according to the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, so I never got caught up in them. But the Adventists had a very solid view on the understanding of the trumpets as presented in Revelation 9, and especially or the last three woes that we're dealing with in Revelation 9. So the woes of Revelation 9, trumpets 5 to 7, are seen on the charts as angels with trumpets and as Mahometan soldiers on horseback. They're found at the bottom right-hand corner of the chart. The angel in the Islamic horse of the fifth trumpet, or is of the fifth trumpet, or first woe, is found to the right and slightly above the woman riding the beast. Under the feet of the top horse, Revelation 9:7 is quoted, And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns of gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And next we see the second angel and the horse representing the sixth trumpet, or the second woe. Notice the horseman is firing a gun. The fire from the gun appears to come from the horse's mouth. And under the second horse, we see the angel of the seventh trumpet. There was no horse pictured with this angel. Does anybody know when the seventh trumpet began to sound? October 22nd, 1844. Okay? So that's when the trumpet began to sound. Now, it is interesting. I obviously am not spending a great deal of time here with the seven trumpets and with the three woes. But it is important to note that there is no way they could have foreseen things that had not yet transpired in regarding to the woes. Okay, so the seventh trumpet began to sound October 22nd, 1844. But what is the third woe? Is the sounding of the trumpet the same as the woe? No, it's not. So there is a period of time in which the woe was going to happen. So when people say that the third woe, you know, happened, it didn't happen. Now the other thing is, the first and second woe are referred to by Islam as the first great jihad and the second great jihad. Okay? They now refer to 9/11 as the third great jihad. So I'm not doing a study on that at the moment, but if we follow through logically, the first two woes are Islam. The third woe is also Islam. So it's something that you may want to study and look into. But you can see it's on the 1843 chart, and we'll see it's also on the 1850 chart as well. So it's something that's very solid within Adventism regarding the trumpets. Now, I just want to spend a bit of time looking at the errors on the 1843 chart. Now, I sometimes run into people when I'm discussing with them on Facebook or Google Plus or through emails. One professor at Andrews, he just says there's all kinds of mistakes on the 1843 chart. Now, I don't think that we should just casually call something a mistake or an error because it doesn't agree with our understanding. We need to study it out from the Word of God. And, you know, these charts were directed, as we read earlier, by the hand of the Lord, right? So God was in the publishment of these charts, the 1843 and the 1850 chart. And so to just, you know, casually dismiss things, you know, we need to know what our teaching was. So whether we agree with it or not, we need to understand and have sound reasons why we are rejecting something that's on these charts. Okay? Now, obviously, Adventism has some of these things, these charts, seem a little strange to us when we first see them. You know, I was an Adventist for 28 years before I'd ever seen these charts. And so sometimes people see them, they get a little bit scared. I mean, they are a little scary. I remember when I was, before I was even an Adventist, I ran across this old Adventist guy in Clearwater, BC. He had a health food store. His name, he called himself Brother Ray, but he had all these images and stuff painted all over inside his house on the walls. And after I was an Adventist, we stopped and stayed at his place when our vehicle broke down in Clearwater. And my little boys at the time, Matt and Joe, were just, you know, 5, 6, 7 years old. They just were so amazed with these images on the walls. They, you know, they wish they had pictures like that in their bedroom. But so they can be a little bit scary. But let's just read it again what Ellen White says. This is from Spalding McGann. She says, "I saw that the truth should be made plain upon tables, that the earth and the fullness thereof is the Lord's, and the necessary means should not be spared to make it plain. I saw that the old chart was directed by the Lord, and that not a figure of it should be altered except by inspiration. I saw that the figures of the chart were as God would have them, and that his hand was over and hid a mistake in some of the figures, so that none should see it till his hand was removed." So if there's errors on this chart, one of the things Ellen White says is this chart is a fulfillment of Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. In Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3, it says, talking about these charts, these tables, that they would speak and not lie. Oops. says in Proverbs 12, verse 17, "He that speaketh truth showeth forth righteousness, but a false witness deceit. And a true witness delivereth souls, but a deceitful witness speaketh lies." Is the 1843 chart a deceitful witness? No. It's obviously a true witness. It had a mistake, which was, and not just, of course, the date, the time, but also they didn't understand the event. But as far as the chart is concerned, it was directed by God. It does not speak lies. As it says, "Though the vision tarry, wait for it, it shall speak and not lie." So Ellen White clearly names the mistake on the 1843 chart. It is the fullness of the year that causes the error in the ending date, 1843, as it relates to the termination of the 2300 days and the 2520 year prophecy. The 1335 year prophecy is unaffected by the mistake. So how many people here are familiar with the 1335 year prophecy, or how many are not? Okay, how many are, I guess is. Okay, so the 1335 year prophecy is connected with the 1260 year prophecy. It begins, it's also connected with the 1290 year prophecy, and it begins at the taking away of the daily. What's that?
Where is it found?
Where is it found? Is it found in Daniel chapter 12? So, I mean, if you want, I could read it for you, but the taking away of the daily, and it ended in, the 1335 ended in 1843. It's not affected by the 0 year because it's not, it doesn't start on the BC side of the calendar, right? It's in AD. "And blessed is he that cometh to the 1335 days." Yes?
Can you explain the 0 year thing?
Okay, so the 0 year, there's the two ways it can be explained, the fullness of the year or the 0 year. There is no 0 year in a calendar. 1 BC is followed by 1 AD. So they didn't take this into account. None of their opponents noticed this. So it is, you know, it's different ways to explain it. Sometimes it confuses people. I don't know. Is anybody confused by it? Like, are you confused by calculating it? Or is you,
I wasn't first, but I think. Yeah. Instead of going from 1 to 1, you go from 1 to 0 to 1, so there's an extra year.
Yeah, there is no 0. Yeah. Right. So it just goes 1 to 1. So we have to add a year when you're doing a calculation between the two. That's why we, it's not 1843, it's 1844. Okay. Does that make sense? Does that help? Actually, I prefer the term fullness of the year because that's the way that it was often talked about by the pioneers. Now, we also have a mistake on the chart, or at least something that people point out as a mistake. There is the year 158 BC, which is the date for the league between the Jews and the Romans. It is now dated 161 BC. So we know in history it was not 158. Miller believed it was 158. Now there was a number of different dates, and you know, I've even found ones that, you know, he could have applied it to 157 BC and so forth. But it is true that Miller had at one time taken the view that there were 660 years from 158 BC to 508 for pagan Rome. Okay, so when the, does that make sense to anybody? So if you add 508 and 158 BC, you get 666. Okay, but the problem is there, he's not taking into account the 0 year. And also, is that right? Yes, I did the math before. I'm just checking my math here. So when we see this on the 1843 chart, we don't see the prophecy dealing with 666 years for pagan Rome. Okay? So there is no prophecy on the chart with this year 158 BC. So if somebody's going to point it out as a mistake, it's not a prophetic mistake. It's just a lack of understanding of history that they had at that time in order to establish this date. Okay? So it's not what Ellen White is including in any of the mistakes in the prophetic periods. Now, another thing that ends up on the chart that gets a little bit confusing is this 45 years. Now, It is presented also in two different ways, or Miller understood it in two different ways. One is it was the difference between 1335 and 1290. So you can see 1335, they both start in 508, and if you subtract 1335 from 1290, there's 45 years. So from 1798 to 1843 is 45 years. Okay? And so you can see there is the 1260. So the 45 years for Miller were not merely a calculation between the ending of the 1260-year prophecy and the second coming of Christ in 1843, but were 45 years left from the setting up of the papacy that were left from the first half of the 2520-year prophecy. So I'm going to let Miller explain this to us. He says, the captivity of Manasseh took place in the year before Christ, 677. If this is the time when the kings of the earth began to rule over Zion and to scatter the power of the holy people for a times and a half, or 1260 years, when will it end? Now he's talking about the prophecy in Daniel chapter 12, verse 7, where it says that the power of the holy people would be scattered for a times and a half. Typically in Adventism, what do we take that period to be? 1260 years, but when do we start it and when do we end it? 538 to 1798. But Miller took that one in Daniel 12, verse 7, and applied it not to papal Rome's 1260 years, but to pagan Rome's 1260 years. And I'm going to explain this in more detail later on, so if it's a little bit fuzzy. Now, he had two different 2520 prophecies, one for Judah and one for Israel, and he applied this one to Judah. We'll see later that this actually would have applied to Israel, not to Judah. But let's go on here. So he says, I answer, when all these things shall be finished, first, the kings exercise their authority 677 years before Christ and 538 years after Christ, which 677 added to 538 makes up 1,215 years. So he's going from the captivity of Manasseh in 677 BC and going to the setting up of the papal power, which is 1,215 years, and he says there's 45 years left over, okay? Which did not accomplish the scattering of the holy people, nor the treading underfoot of the court 42 months, or the 1,260 years. And this is the reason why John was not to measure, because it would not be fulfilled until mystical Babylon should wear out the saints and change the times and laws, a times and a half. For God had put it into the hearts of these kings to fulfill his will and to agree to give their kingdom unto the mystery of Babylon or papal Rome until a 1260 years of mystical Babylon should be fulfilled, which 1260 years added to 538, when the kings became of one mind, converted to the Orthodox faith, gave up their power to the Bishop of Rome, and the power of the papacy began, will carry us down to the year 1798. So it's a bit convoluted the way he writes it. But he just shows the 1260 years for papal Rome end in 1798. And he says, when the kings again took their power, that is, they took the Pope captive, and will now accomplish the scattering of the holy people by reigning from 1798 to 1843, which is 45 years, add which to 1215, which the kings had reigned before mystical Babylon obtained the power, and we have 1260 years of the king's reign, scattering the holy people, treading underfoot the sanctuary and host, which is properly the court, where the host stands waiting the return of our great high priest, who will return to bless his people in turning every one of them from their sins and their iniquities in Zion. And that's William Miller's Dissertations on the True Inheritance of the Saints, page 45. So, I mean, if anybody has questions later, I can explain this again. But hopefully by the end of these presentations, you'll see quite clearly how this fits. Now there is a mistake that the Millerites believe that did not end up on the 1843 chart, and this one is very significant, and we're going to deal with this in detail. Most Adventists do not know that the Millerites never understood the 70th week of Daniel's 70-week prophecy as being fulfilled by the crucifixion of Christ in the middle of the week. That is, they had, Miller had Christ crucified in 33 AD, and which is at the end of the 70th week. He did not have him crucified in the midst of the week. And this is a really important point, and you'll see how it applies as I go through each of these charts. So, miraculously, this prophecy, which is a time prophecy, which they had miscalculated, not understood properly, does not end up on the chart. There is nothing here on the chart. You can see on this is on the left column. They have the crucifixion of Christ, but they don't, you know, they have it between 100 and, you know, the non-zero year there. Right? But no date. And also here, where it talks about 457 BC, it talks about Daniel chapter 8 and 9 for the start of the 2300 days, makes no mention of the 70 weeks. So one of the objections that people have is, and maybe some of you have run into this, when Ellen White talks about the prophetic periods in Great Controversy 351 and in early writings, they say that she's talking about the 2300 days is the prophetic periods. Now, are the 2300 days prophetic periods? No, they're not. So they say it's divided into two prophetic periods, 70 weeks and 810 years. And there is a fulfillment of the 810 years, which applies, which we now understand as Seventh-day Adventists, but Millerites didn't understand because they didn't understand Christ's ministry in the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. But my point is, the 70 weeks, even if they were part of the prophetic periods, are not on the 1843 chart. So if she's talking about the figures that were on the chart as prophetic periods, she can only be talking about two prophetic periods that ended in 1843 or seen to end in 1843 that were then seen to end in 1844, and that's the seven times of Leviticus 26 and the 2300 days of Daniel chapter 8. Okay? Now, one of the things, of course, that was a mistake is not just the date, 1843, but what was going to happen. God's everlasting kingdom was going to come in. And it says, God designed to prove his people. His hand covered a mistake in the reckoning of the prophetic periods, which of course cannot be the 70 weeks and the 1810 years because they're not on those charts. Adventists did not discover the error, nor was it discovered by the most learned of their opponents. The latter said, your reckoning of the prophetic periods is correct. Some great event is about to take place, but it is not what Mr. Miller predicts. It is the conversion of the world and not the second advent of Christ. And that's from Great Controversy 373. So the mistake was not in the reckoning of the prophetic periods as far as 1844 is concerned. There was a mistake as far as 1843 was concerned. She says later in the Great Controversy 424, both the prophecy of Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And the first angel's message, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, pointed to Christ's ministration in the most holy place, to the investigative judgment, and not to the coming of Christ for the redemption of his people and the destruction of the wicked. The mistake had not been in the reckoning of the prophetic periods, but in the event to take place at the end of the 2300 days. Through this error, the believers had suffered disappointment, yet all that was foretold by the prophecy and all that they had any scripture warrant to expect had been accomplished at the very time when they were lamenting the failure of their hopes. The event had taken place which was foretold by the message and which must be fulfilled before the Lord could appear to give reward to his servants. Okay, now I'm going to answer questions. I'm just going to, can somebody turn on the lights there? I mean, thank you. So is there any questions? I can write things on the board. Any questions regarding any of these prophetic periods or things that you think were not very clear? should have you guys write questions down.
One of the things that I found interesting was that even the most learned of their opponents didn't see the mistake. So that just confirms Habakkuk's words that what was it?
God's hand was over and hid a mistake in the figures.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, you know, some people question, is God deceiving man? Well, the thing is, this is a mistake that man made. But God also had written that this was going to happen. I mean, it's, you know, as I look at it, we look at it in our own lives. You know, there's things that I should have known, right? They were right there all the time. But I didn't see them. And sometimes it wasn't the time for me to see them. I was not prepared. I had to go through an experience so that I could appreciate what it was that God wanted to teach me. And this is the way it is with us as individuals. This is the way it is with God's people. The way it is with nations. Right? God's dealings are ever the same. Right? He wants to teach us step by step.
That mistake is one of the things that generally as Adventists, we sort of stand there, look at the dirt and kick in the dust and say, well, you know, we don't really know why they made that mistake. Yeah. And we try to make excuses rather than actually be able to glorify God that he saw it. It was designed as a test for his people.
Well, the disciples experienced a mistake, right? They experienced the disappointment. And theirs was regarding to the event that was going to happen at the end of the 70-week prophecy. Right? They're expecting their Messiah to come and deliver them. And instead their Messiah was crucified. And I remember when I first became an Adventist, the first book I read was Kingdom of the Cults by Walter Martin. The appendix called The Puzzle of Seventh-day Adventism. And in that... In that book, I mean, one thing I recognized, even though I knew very little, is that if you wanted to attack Adventism, you needed to attack the chronologies. You needed to attack the dates. And the disappointment, you know, when we look at the Millerite movement, for many Adventists, we see Miller as full of errors. A lot of people say, don't read Miller, he's full of errors. But you will not find that if you read Miller. You will find that there are some things that he could not see, but he's not full of errors. His reasoning is sound. His approach to studying the Bible is sound. He just could not see events beyond 1843, 44, because that's as far as his vision could allow. And so things that we now see stretching over a long period of time, for Miller, those events were going to happen in a very short period of time. Okay, yes, Rick?
Why is there so much confusion about the daily when it's so plain from the charts? Is it because of the hand being over?
Well, with the daily, you know, all were united in the correct view of the daily, Ellen White says in page 74 of early writings. Now, there's a quote, which I'm going to get for you here, dealing with the new view of the daily. Fortunately, somebody put it on their Facebook page. It's at the top of your Facebook page, Kelly?
It's somewhere there. You can actually give Dana credit on that one.
Yep. You got a lot of stuff pasted, so... Do you have the quote there? You have lots of advertising for the presentations here. Yep. Okay.
I've always wondered.
Yep.
Why did Miller and the so-called opponents ignore the Bible clearly that no one knows when Christ is coming?
Well, actually, Miller didn't. He actually did not believe that he knew the day or the hour when Christ was going to return. He always said about the year 1843.
Yeah, first of all, weren't specific instructions given that nobody's supposed to predict on dates?
Yeah.
There was no prophecy supposed to be forward unless a servant of the Lord received a message for that thing.
Yeah. Well, I think with Miller, the question regarding, you know, why did they set a date? I mean, Miller was just saying these prophecies point to 1843 or about the year 1843. As they got nearer, they wanted to have more dates. And it wasn't so much Miller that was even saying, you know, when 1843 ended in the spring, that that's, you know, a disappointment. But it was because they were expecting, you know, Christ to return. In the Midnight Cry, when Samuel Snow presented evidences for October 22nd, 1844, Miller was very reluctant and was one of the last to accept the October 22nd, 1844 date. But there just was so much overwhelming evidence that something was going to happen on that date that, yeah, well, it did.
But it didn't say, you know, that was the end. That was the whole thing.
Yeah. Well,
did you find it?
No, I didn't find it.
It's down like 11 o'clock at
night. Okay. Well, well, if you bring it here, I can read it. Yeah, it's a very good question, by the way. Okay, so this is Ellen White. She says, I copy from my diary the truth as it is in Jesus. Talk it, pray it, believe every word in its simplicity. What would you gain if mistakes are brought before the men who have departed from the faith and given heed to seducing spirits, men who were not long ago with us in the faith, who will stand on the devil's side? Will you stand on the devil's side? She asks. Give your attention to the unworked fields. A worldwide work is before us. I was given representations of John Kellogg. A very attractive personage was presenting the ideas of the specious arguments that he was presenting, sentiments different from the genuine Bible truth. And those who are hungering and thirsting after something new were advancing ideas so specious that Elder Prescott was in great danger. Elder Daniels was in great danger of becoming wrapped in a delusion that if these sentiments could be spoken everywhere, it would be as a new world. Yes, it would. But while their minds were thus absorbed, I was shown that Brother Daniels and Brother Prescott were weaving into their experience sentiments of a spiritualistic appearance and drawing our people to beautiful sentiments that would deceive, if possible, the very elect. I have to trace with my pen the fact that these men would see defects in their delusive ideas that would place the truth in an uncertainty, and yet they would stand out as if they had great spiritual discernment. Now I am to tell them that when I was shown this matter, when Elder Daniels was lifting up his voice like a trumpet in advocating his ideas of the daily, the after results were presented. Our people were becoming confused. I saw the result, and then there were given me cautions that if Elder Daniels, without respect to the outcome, should thus be impressed and let himself believe he was under the inspiration of God, skepticism would be sown among our ranks everywhere, and we would be where Satan would carry his messages. Set unbelief and skepticism would be sown in human minds, and strange crops of evil would take the place of truth. This is manuscript 67, 1910, pages 1 to 8. It's
Manuscript
67, 1910. That's what it says.
Yeah.
Okay. So, obviously, the things that have happened in Adventism, I don't think we should focus upon all the negative things. We just need light and truth ourselves individually. Obviously, all different kinds of errors have crept in. And I don't think we can deny that. But what's important for us now is to know our history and to examine these things for ourselves. So if there isn't any more questions. Yes, you have? Revelation 9? Yes, so Revelation 9, I touched on it, just that the third woe is Islam. And we believe that we're in the time of the third woe. So the seventh trumpet began to sound October 22nd, 1844. But the third woe, which Islam is to protect God's people, that attack that happened in 9/11 was something that took heat off of God's people. So there is evidence that persecution would have moved much faster had it not been for 9/11, even though it may seem opposite to some people. But that's the part of 9/11. Any other brief questions?
Wasn't there a quote also that had the incorrect view of the day came from the angels who were expelled from?
Yes. Where is that? I don't know where it is offhand. Yeah, I know you're not computer literate, but you know anybody who has a computer and Ellen White's disc, you know, you can just search the daily in quotes and you'll find all these different quotes. One of the things that was happening is Ellen White says, you know, she has no light on this, the view of the daily. And what she was, this daily, she's talking about, she's saying that she has no light in the understanding of what Daniels and Prescott were presenting. She's not saying that she didn't have light upon the true view of the daily. She just didn't have light upon, she didn't see any light in this new view. And she didn't feel that either the old or the new view should be made a point of contention, that people should study this out individually, not in the church papers, which of course, you know, people shouldn't be just going around creating dissension among brethren. So she wasn't against studying the new view, but she wanted, you know, people to do it in a Christ-like manner. Okay, so I'm going to just close with prayer and then we'll take a short break. So let's just kneel for prayer, where possible. Dear Father in heaven, we are thankful, Lord, for those souls that have come here on this Sabbath to look at your work in the church, in your denominated people, in the early history. And we just pray, Lord, that you can continue to be with us in our discussions, that you can guide our minds, keep our thoughts clear, and that these truths of your word, we can seek them out individually. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer again. And we pray this in Jesus' name.